This is the same way in every neighborhood. Is the tactic used in different ways, and is the result the same? The outcome's the same. So I think it's a mixed bag. I mean, when I started working on profiling, which was, I don't want to tell you how many years ago, what we got was straight up denial. This is not a problem. You're making this up to stir up racial resentment. I heard that many, many times. And you can't prove it. And then the statistics began to come out, and then the reply got different. Well, we actually do this to control crime, because those are the right people. And so then the task became, well, does it really work that way? And the focal point of my work for many years has been to show, the results showed, I should say. I mean, I did start out with this, but results from study after study after study, pretty much any kind of state, jurisdiction, city, wherever you are, that the hit rate, the rate of success that police have in finding bad guys, finding guns, finding drugs, whatever they're after, when they use race as one factor, the success rate goes down. It doesn't help them, they don't stay the same, it actually goes down. Because the things they should be paying attention to, the behavior, has less of a focus. Other questions? Happy to answer any and all. Yes, ma'am?
Local news as well, okay, because this is an important part of the picture.
the role of the CSI programs and all those things that are going on that show this science melded with police work has created a real problem for police and prosecutors. A real problem. They call this the CSI effect. It is causing people to be impaneled in juries who have unrealistic expectations of police and prosecutors. They think science can solve anything, and in an hour, what's the big deal? So you'll find cases prosecuted in which lots and lots of forensic testing is done just to cross these dot I's, not because it actually means anything, but because people are saying stuff like, well, he never took fingerprints off that bag, never even tried, so not guilty. And so they're having to fight a whole battle against that fiction, an unrealistic view of the world that science solves everything. And the role of the media is, if anything, even worse when we talk about nonfiction material, news. Still today, with the internet and all the rest of it, great majority of people get their news from local television newscasts. That's still true today. And if you turn on the news in any city, whether it's Chicago or where I live, Pittsburgh or San Francisco or New York, I can guarantee you the first couple of stories are about blood, guts, shooting, and knives. I mean, that's right? There's an old saying in the news business, if it bleeds, it leads. Right? This is what keeps people interested, keeps them hooked on the program. And so, even though crime has been inching down and really down for 20 years, unprecedented changes in American society, a city like New York, much, much safer than it used to be. You know, it's been down, 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 down. You could be excused if you had an idea that in your city, crime was up, 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 right? Because that's what you see all the time. Now, it depends very much on where you live, right? Because we all know sometimes it's concentrated in certain areas. But in general, that media picture in the news is very inaccurate. And you could really believe that you have huge crime sprees that happen every November and every May. They just go crazy. There's all kinds of violence on the street, and people are going nuts. Why November and May? Ratings month. Ratings month. So they really trot out that blood and guts, right? So we get a bad idea of what's going on, and it's really hard to do thoughtful reform in a climate like that, because the voters still think it's a jungle out there, when in most places it's not nearly as bad as it used to be. Most places, some places it's worse. Yes?
How is the video technology coming along with evidence?
Ma'am, one more time?
How is the video technology coming along with evidence?
Video technology for evidence. Very interesting question. As I said, everybody's got a recordable device, a recording device in their pocket now. So recordings popping up on YouTube hours after somebody gets arrested, no longer unusual. And these have had a very interesting effect. Police in general don't like this big change. They don't like to be photographed or filmed, and yet cameras are everywhere. And it doesn't always, you know, things that get on YouTube, let's face it, they're not gonna get on there when they show the police doing a great job. This is one of the reasons that when I'm working with police departments, I encourage them to embrace this in the form of body cameras, right? And this was something that the judge in New York in the Floyd case has actually ordered testing of in New York, but this isn't the first place it will be done. These body cameras are small, sometimes they clip onto a lapel or a tie or a hat, sometimes you wear it like a Bluetooth sort of earpiece, and they make great recordings from the point of view of the police officer. And unlike the cameras in the cars that show one view out the window, they're where the police officer is, right? And when these were, they were piloted first in the UK, officers love them. Officers love them. It collects evidence, it protects them against bogus claims. People behave better in front of cameras, it turns out. Surprise, right? And they behave better whether they're civilians or police officers. They have all kinds of good effects. It really does a nice job. They're now being used full-time in some cities in California. Cincinnati is another place. But I predict in 5 years, you're going to have officers most places using those things. I think that will make a big difference in a lot of on-the-street encounters. But it will also require a rule, like what I was talking about before. If you don't use it, it can't come in as evidence. So you're going to have some kind of rule that for every encounter with a civilian, it goes on, whether automatically or by a switch. But that's coming. That's coming.
We probably have time for one more question if there's one final one.
Well, seeing none, I want to tell you that I really enjoyed this. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you. Thank you, Professor Barrett and the Center. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks again. And I also just wanted to announce that next week, same time, same place, we are going to have what I think is going to be a really fascinating discussion with Penny Gearson, who's the victim that was involved in the long identification and sort of hearing her perspective on that and her ideas about reforms as well. So look forward to that, and hope to see that if people have more. Thanks.
Thank you.